I think that every team in the National Hockey League are looking for a guy like that.
While some players thrive under that microscope, others crumble. And now, all eyes are on yet another prodigy.
He's the real deal.
His work habits are impeccable and his focus is tremendous.
Each game he can do something new.
This is not just a guy you say, wow. This is a guy you say, oh, this is something.
Talent that you need to be a hockey player, this youngster's got it.
In Canada, where hockey rules the sporting landscape, every decade seems to produce one player whose abilities elevate him to mythic proportions before he plays a single game in the NHL. Canada's greatest game has found its newest name, Sidney Crosby. His story is not unlike those before him. Growing up in a small Canadian town and dominating the ice while others were learning to walk.
It's tough. I mean, when you grow up in a, I guess, in a way, it's a small town on its own. I mean, it's hard because, you know, you're doing well in a small town, but then, you know, you have to realize, hey, it's a small place. You know, I think the first time I realized that, you know, maybe I could do something special is maybe... And midget. I was 14 and I went top scorer and MVP at the Air Canada Cup. It's a national tournament.
Here's a break for Crosby. Sidney Crosby's right in. Backhander stopped by Fisher and score.
I was 2 years underage, so at that point I was like, hey, I can compete with these guys. And, I really realized that, maybe I can go somewhere in hockey.
Though he was a hockey prodigy in Canada, a 14-year-old Sidney Crosby would graduate to hockey phenom in California.
I was living in LA and he was at a summer sort of camp. It was mostly 17 and 18 year old kids who were gonna be high first round picks, some second round picks. So there's a lot of good talent out there. And the one youngster who caught my eye the most was a kid out there who was only 14 at the time. Honestly, I was so impressed by it that the next day I went back and I actually got on the ice to play with him.
It was a surprise, actually. I mean, he just stepped out of the room and there he was skating around the ice.
I just wanted to be out there with him and see it firsthand.
Just remember all the guys skating around and he had a puck and, you know, guys shoot the puck against the boards and puck would kind of bounce somewhere, but no one would touch his puck. Like, you know, if it was anyone else, everyone would just kind of pick up the next one, but no one would go near him. He was a whole zone away from everyone else. It was hilarious, but just unbelievable to be on the same ice as him. And we got a chance to play 3-on-3, and you know, it was kind of cheating my way down the bench to make sure I got out with him. And no, it was unbelievable.
And first of all, he's more talented than any 14 or 15 year old I've seen in a long time. I think the last guy that I saw that good at that age was probably Mario Lemieux. But you could tell that he had a passion for the game and an excitement about playing hockey that I hadn't seen in a long time.
And Wayne wasn't shy when asked about Sidney's future.
We all remember what Wayne Gretzky said. If someone can break my record, it will be Sidney Crosby. At 15 years old, it's very hard to manage that.
At 15, Sidney got his first taste of a season away from home, going to Minnesota and Shattuck St. Mary's. Distance and high school competition did nothing to slow Sidney down.
At that time, you know, he was new to that league. He was a younger player in that league, as he has been everywhere he's gone. Always been a younger player doing well, and he was just really dominating mentally.
From there, it was off to finishing school for phenoms, Canadian Major Junior Hockey. Playing for the Rimouski Oceanic, before sold-out crowds and standing ovations, Crosby Mania has reached its apex.
I think that what we call a pure talent. I think Sidney Crosby is the best player I ever saw in 10 years at junior level. The brute talent is the most the best I saw in this category.
He's a tremendous skater. He shoots the puck well. He sees the ice incredibly well. He's just a very intelligent hockey player. He led the league in scoring at his age, and it's been some time since we've seen a Crosby come along.
I like to say it's a phenom outside the ice too.
When you have your autograph, please leave the place for the other person.
There you go. Thank you very much. Best of luck in your career. Thanks. There you
go. Thanks a lot for the tickets, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
Anytime.
Thanks a lot.
Great game tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're hot stuff out there on the ice.
Can you come for a picture?
Go ahead.
Go first.
Thank you. You want one?
Sure.
Colby, you going with Sydney too? Go ahead. Go with Sydney. He's been asking the whole game. There he is.
He changes his mind over here.
Sidney Crosby, phenom, superstar, and already an ambassador for the game of hockey. But before any of that, he is a 17-year-old celebrity who will repeat this scenario every night in every arena he plays.
You understand, he have a part to do with the media, a part to do with the fans, and he do that easy each day. He receives some call, or after each game, a lot of people wait for him for the autograph, and you always do that with a smile.
It's probably in some ways difficult, more difficult than people really understand. He's not the first guy that's gone through this, and he won't be the last. That's just part of the goes along with being that good of a player.
Hype in the 70s, 80s, even the 90s was one thing. But hype in 2005, that's a whole different level of pressure.
Having been a former first-round pick, first overall, the difference now versus then is that the exposure is 100 times more.
I don't think I met the media until draft day, you know, in 1973.
You draw a crowd everywhere you go, cameras and everything. How do you feel about that? Is that just
become part of my hobby life, I guess.
It's bigger.
Thank you.
There's more media, there's more hockey cards out, there's more promotional opportunity. It's actually, it's just expanded, it's grown.
Snowball is rolling. People know about him, want to know more about him.
Well, big dreams on the part of a Maritimer named Sidney Crosby. Many think he may be the next great Canadian hockey player.
You know, it's like the stars with the paparazzi, eh?
Crosby! 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 Crosby!
There's so many expectations and so much hype surrounding him.
It's unbelievable how he's big. Sometimes the media can't understand how is it because they ask for his request, but they don't know how many requests we receive.
How many autographs do you think you've signed so far?
I don't know. I have really no idea. A lot.
For Sidney Crosby, it's one heck of a time for this guy.
What's more painful right now, your legs from skating or your wrist from signing autographs?
I think the legs for sure.
He is in the media mecca right now. He is the hockey for Canada.
Sidney Crosby reminds me a lot of Peter Forsberg. In fact, I would say they're very comparable at the same age.
And if any doubt remains as to the status of Crosby mania here in Kitchener, behind me are the back doors to the Kitchener Memorial Auditorium, and they're the ones used by the PR staff of Canada this morning to sneak Sidney out of the auditorium.
It's incredible, and the more information that people have about you, clearly the more expectations people have. And in a lot of ways, that's unfair for young people. Sidney hasn't asked for that. He just wants to be the best player he can be.
For the truest measure of Crosby mania, perhaps nothing speaks louder than the words of those who've lived through hype before, when two of the NHL's brightest young stars were themselves members of the Oceanic.
For me, it's a great experience. I had the chance to describe games with Brad Richards and Vince LeCavalier when they were in the junior level. It was great, but I think it's bigger right now. We can compare the both. With Vince and Brad, Richard, they are two players unbelievable to have a chance to saw them play for us, and they have a lot of attention. But Sidney, at 16 years old, before we draft him, we received some calls because they know we have the first pick, and we received some calls from the media for talk with him.
Before he came in the Junior Hockey League in Quebec,
He was already known by everybody, and everybody, every experts said he can't miss his chance to be one of the greatest player of all time.
Coming up, it's obvious all eyes are on Sydney, but what happens as a result can be difficult.
It's been like that since I can remember. I mean, you know, since Pee Wee Adam, it's always been that way. There's been a guy shadowing me, or, you know, guys taking runs and things like that.
And a former number one pick talks about another potential pitfall.
A lot of people didn't like me on the team that didn't know me. Kind of figured that out. That kind of rubbed me the wrong way, or certainly threw me for a loop, because I've never had really dealt with that before.
Oh, and here they are now.
Anyone who's been through it, it can be tough. For Sidney Crosby, it has already begun. And with the attention he gets comes not only pressure, but physical abuse at the hands of his opponents.
From the first game, the attitude of the other team is they are mad at him sometimes. You know, there was some jealousy. He didn't ask for that, but it's all the exposure he's getting, and to some other players against him, they don't appreciate to see that. And I'm not saying they are really and always playing dirty against him, but they are playing more dirty than in the past.
It's been like that since I can remember. I mean, you know, since Pee Wee Adam, it's always been that way. There's been a guy shadowing me, or, you know, guys taking runs and things like that, and I look to it as a challenge. I mean, anytime that happens, sure, it gets frustrating after a while when, you know, guys keep doing that, but you gotta learn to deal with it and, you know, still succeed, you know, while going through that.
I can say, because I see all the games, I can say for 10 moves by an opponent who earned a penalty, we have 1-2 penalties called, and maybe 8 or 9 supposed to who are not.
I'm not blaming it. Oh, we know you want to protect him. You want to protect him. You want to give him a special status. No, it's not the way. So that's why it's tougher this season.
While jealousy and physical abuse are to be expected from opponents, they're not supposed to be part of how you are received by your teammates. However, when you enter the NHL amidst hype and expectations, sometimes you can be judged before you even arrive.
The biggest thing I'll always remember is coming in, a lot of hype, obviously, having been a first pick. A lot of people didn't like me on the team that didn't know me. Kind of figured that out. That kind of rubbed me the wrong way, or certainly threw me for a loop, because I'd always been a captain and very well liked, and never had really dealt with that before.
In 1983, Brian Lawton was the first American chosen number one overall in the entry draft.
When you get to the draft and you see the hype and you just, you know, you feel the electricity and you see the Wayne Gretzky's and people that were my idols growing up, I think at that moment it really, you know, it really kind of rings home. Now, when you roll it forward and you finally sign a contract, and then you get in there and you start to deal with some of the intricacies of being a professional that maybe you haven't seen as an amateur player. You may have guys that are jealous of you, that don't want to like you, that think you're a silver spooner or whatever. Those are, when you start to deal with those issues, that's when you really start to realize that there is a part of this that is a job.
It's not easy being billed as a savior. In fact, if the situation isn't right, it can be downright scary. Lawton's high school coach, Bill Belisle, found that out when he visited Brian during his rookie year.
During the game, you know, I couldn't notice it, but I wasn't really, really sure. So when he came out and I saw him, he was all cut up, bruised, unbelievable. And I know damn well that didn't happen in the game against the Whalers. Now, he got physically hit, but no, nothing. I says, "Ryan, good job, this and that." No, he says, "I'm glad you came, coach, so I love you." And I says, "Before I go," I says, "what'd you call that bruise?" Oh, he says, "Coach," he says, "I get that in practices." "What?" Oh, he says, "They all on my head in practices." "No kidding." "Oh, no," he said, "believe me, it's, I'd rather play games than practices." That's what he had to fight till he got out of it. I mean, till he retired.
When I look back now on my first, I played in the NHL from 18 to 22. and really had no idea what was going on for about the first 4 years, essentially my college years. It's just, it flies by so quickly. You know, it just takes getting in there and going through those experiences to learn. And it'll be the same for Sydney.
So the question then becomes, what situation would benefit Sydney the most when he enters the NHL?
I think in some situations, if you're handed the whole franchise and you're expected right off the bat, it's not a lot of players can actually do that.
To come in as a savior and to really make a difference in hockey, it's not like basketball where you can have the ball, you know, for essentially half the game for your team. I mean, in hockey, it's a team sport, and one player cannot carry a team by himself.
If he does come into a team that's down on the lower echelon of teams, hopefully they'll really be patient with him and work with him. Because I still think that jump from junior to pro, you know, you're skipping, you know, the minor leagues in there, and you're skipping another, you know, couple of levels of play international. It's a big jump. And I don't, you know, I guess unless you're Wayne Gretzky, Bobby Orr, or Mario Lemieux, maybe, and he might be in that category because we've heard about him at such a young age that he can actually step right in and do amazing things.
Lemieux, for instance, the first pick in the 1984 entry draft, was asked to revive a struggling franchise right away.
Mario did come into a very difficult situation, there's no doubt about it. And the biggest thing with him, and it was similar with Eric Lindros, is when those guys came in, they were physically imposing people. I mean, I can remember watching Mario carry, I believe it was Karkner, you know, in on a one-on-one, go around him and just Karkner jump on his back and Mario carry him into the net. And for him to do that as a young person was really impressive to everybody.
You know, you think of Lemieux was able to do it, and even then I don't think he made the playoffs till his seventh year. So it's not an easy thing to just be able to just jump right in there.
And while Lemieux was successful on the ice, off it, he struggled with the expectations that came with those successes.
He handled things in his own way. You know, he wasn't as positive a spokesperson in his younger days as a Wayne Gretzky was. He didn't come in with that. He came in with a little bit more shyness in some ways. But Wayne Gretzky, in my opinion, has been one of the best ever. Not just as a player, we all know that, but as a young person carrying a league. Wayne just, he had a knack, and he's still doing it to this moment today, of saying the right thing at the right time. To hold everybody else to his standard is a very, very difficult bar.
A standard that Sydney is already being held to.
And as we look at Sidney Crosby, you know, people already are comparing him to Wayne and a lot of great things he did. That's unfair for a young person. But professional sports is not fair. It's never been fair. But you got to get in tune with what the rules are. And Sidney will be treated very well wherever he goes. And he'll get some privileges that other guys normally wouldn't have afforded to him by virtue of what he's done in the past. That will irritate people. That will make people jealous of him. Those are not things that Sidney's asking for or demanding. You know, those are just things that people will give him. You know, that's just the way life is.
Up next.
I'm just missing the puck sometimes. Just the arms just give out.
You'll find out why Sid's arms are so tired as All Access takes you to an NHL prospect camp. On the ice, in the weight room.
That's it, Sid. Strong mind. That's it. Strong mind.
And even to the batting cages, where Sid performs a few impersonations.
This is Batista right here. This is Batista. Oh, pitch it.
When NHL All Access Becoming Sidney Crosby returns. The Great One's legacy hangs over Sidney's every move. Summer 2004 saw Crosby's return to the Kings prospect camp and another chance to sharpen his skills.
Myself and Jack Johnson also went, so we just got a chance to go out there and just basically be in an NHL development camp, and it was a huge eye-opener. I mean, the skill level and you know, the intensity, that was awesome. It was a big eye-opener for me. Like I said, it's just was really high skilled, and you know, it was definitely a big challenge.
I think in terms of asking me to evaluate Sidney Crosby, that question's probably been answered 1,000 times. And the best way to evaluate Sidney Crosby is to come and watch him play. His overall skill level is obviously very, very good, but his competitive nature and drive to play and passion for the game of hockey are certainly something that is an inspiration to anybody.
A player like Sidney, what I'm most impressed with is how hard he competes. He works as hard or harder than anybody on the ice, and I think that's probably the biggest reason he's as good as he is.
Considered by many the best hockey prospect in over a decade, Crosby remains grounded, willing to earn his respect, and realizing no task is beneath him.
I've always kind of helped out picking up the pucks, but especially when you're a younger guy, it's almost just a given. It's almost like an unwritten rule. You just do it, and you don't even think about it. It's just, that's not even a big deal for me. I mean, you know, some guys would, you know, look at the pucks, and, you know, I don't want to pick those up. It doesn't matter to me. I mean, I'm out there using them. I don't mind putting them away.
Did Jack help you put them away?
Or? I didn't see him there, so, you know, we might have a little chat with that.
Oh, yeah.
Crosby's roommate in L.A. is Jack Johnson, another highly touted prospect. The two share a friendship that dates back to their high school days at Shattuck St. Mary's, forged from a love of the game they excel at and a deep respect for each other.
One thing I've always admired about him is how competitive, and he never, you know, never takes that shift off. And, you know, he's made it to such a, you know, high level, and he's so much more advanced than everyone else, and he's just always working and competing. And, you know, he's been able to, you know, be, you know, kind of a big star and everything, but still be, you know, great person off the ice. Because I, you know, I've played with a lot of great hockey players that are just, you know, you'd rather do anything but, you know, spend be in the same room with them. But Sid's definitely got that combination of being a great guy and still competing and trying to get better and, you know, being a big star on the ice.
Their day just beginning. The future first-round draft picks head off to Gold's Gym and a dry land workout under the watchful eye of training guru T.R. Goodman.
Any little areas where you have weaknesses, by you controlling your pace, you're going to eliminate those weaknesses. Both legs already?
Yeah.
It was a great workout, intense workouts. The atmosphere there is unbelievable with so many NHL guys, and you see how focused they are on and off the ice. You know, it's a good atmosphere to be in.
Make your mind control your body. Build endurance into your legs now. Build endurance into your legs. Don't break your rhythm. Don't break your rhythm. Don't break your rhythm. Strong mind. You see, when Mario was here working out, that guy's mind is so strong. You got a strong mind too. Because Sidney's mind is so strong, he's way, way, way beyond his years in terms of the way that he carries himself, the kind of questions that he asks. He's just a gifted person mentally. I mean, the other day he was here and he was working out with Mario, and he's like a VCR. He absorbs everything. He saw the approach that Mario was taking in terms of, I mean, that's one of Mario's greatest gifts too, is his ability to have great mental focus, great mental concentration. And Sidney has the same gift, and to see them two working out together side by side, it was really amazing, because a bomb could have gone off and neither one of them would have paid any attention to it. That's it, Sid. Strong mind. That's it. Strong mind.
You have to work hard. I mean, he tries to look at it from a mental side too. I mean, the workouts we do aren't the easiest, and you know, there's a lot of pain. I mean, you're always burning with him. So I think he tries to teach you a lot about, you know, how to handle it mentally too, and just make sure you get the best out of yourself when you're in there, because in the long run, it's going to pay off.
Time off. Sid and Jack use their short break from the day's training as any other 16-year-old would.
Come on.
Oh, my
God.
Goose egg. Yes.
Are you kidding me?
This is Griffey right here. This is Bonds. Oh, you can't be that close. Anyway.
I'm sorry.
This is Batista right here. This is Batista. Oh, pitch it.
This is it,
right?
This is it, huh?
Come on.
It's all right.
Get out of here.
Get out of here.
Do I get a ring for that?
Don't talk to me.
When the forward turns, does he open up, or do you just want him to turn?
You might as well open up. Gives him a little more time to pivot. Okay. Get to the middle of the ice.
I'll lift the lumber there, Seth. How's that holding up?
It's good. Yeah, it's a big tree.
I don't think you can go wrong with the animals.
They get whippy fast. Wood. After two or three ice times, whippy is good.
I'm just missing the puck sometimes. Just the arms just give out.
Hey, is your chest like trembling? Huh? Like shaking?
Yeah, my arms are.
Yeah, I'm shaking.
When I'm sitting like this?
Yeah, I'm shaking. That can't be good.
With every graceful stride, Sidney Crosby gets one step closer to the NHL. Gifted beyond his years, perhaps his greatest attribute is Crosby makes those he plays with better, just like those who came before him. And yet, through all the hype and accolades, he remains respectful and humble.
He might be the most highly touted player since Mario. I mean, certainly the numbers that he's putting up in the Quebec League are rivaling what Mario did.
I got a chance to be around Mario a little bit more. Like, we were training at the same gym, and got to skate with him probably for 6 or 7 days. He was training for the World Cup, so he was out there, and we were playing 3-on-3, 5-on-5, all that stuff together, and just got a chance to hang out with him away from the ice, too. He's a great guy, and told me to enjoy it. That was his best advice, just enjoy the time right now, and like I said before, don't look too far ahead. Just enjoy playing junior, and that was unbelievable, just hearing that from him.
Coming up, Crosby takes a stab at my job. You'll go behind the scenes of the 2004 entry draft and hear from Sidney how he'll feel on his draft day.
There's no pressure for me being here, so it's great, but next year I'm going to be a mess.
And
draft, Washington Capitals are pleased to select Alexander Ovechkin.
That pick in June 2004 surprised nobody on the draft floor. However, the sight of another young man turned more than a few general managers' heads. No stranger to being on TV, this was Sidney Crosby's first time as co-host.
Joining me now, possibly the first pick in next year's draft, Mr. Sidney Crosby. How are you, Sidney?
Good, how are you?
I'm good. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Being down here on the draft floor, getting a feel for next year, do you get nervous already?
Yeah, I do. I think it's a lot easier just being here, taking it all in. I mean, I think there's a lot of nerves for the guys who are going to get drafted, and I'm just happy to be here, and there's no pressure for me being here, so it's great, but next year I'm going to be a mess.
All right, he did fine there, but not everything comes naturally to Sid.
Pierre McGuire, besides Mario Lemieux, who's the best first overall pick in history of the NHL?
I'll cue you, all right?
Can you hear me?
Oh, he's getting good at this. Is it good for you?
Can I stand on this step?
Or should I stand on this step?
Wait, which one?
He's busting my chest.
No, which one? Because I'm smaller here, but I'm taller here, so.
And when he wasn't cracking on me, he was catching up with old friends.
Do you have the Slovakia World Junior team or anything like that?
Yeah.
In the summer?
Yeah.
Awesome. Do you like to be home with all the food?
Oh, yeah, man.
To date, success has smiled upon Sidney as he ascends the hockey ladder, but there is still one rung left at the top.
The real challenge or dilemma for him will be when he can no longer dominate the way that you always have. You know, you just really can't explain it, it just happens. Sidney hasn't got to that yet, so it's been all roses, but when he does get to that, I personally think he'll do very well because his character is very strong, but it still will be new to him and he'll still have some bumps in the road.
The best scenario for Sidney Crosby would be what I had. One coach for the first 13 years of your career.
Let's bear down. You got maybe another half an hour, so bear down for half an hour. Do it right.
In 1984, Potvin and the Islanders welcomed another highly touted first rounder to an organization that was the model of consistency.
For myself, everything clicked right away. Things fell into place. I was with the championship hockey team, and the New York Islanders. They just came off winning 4 Stanley Cups. I get to watch Brian Trotche, who was great, took me under his wing and taught me a lot. And Mike Bossy and Dennis Potvin. And I look back at my first 3 weeks becoming a New York Islander, and it was every dream come true.
Starting his career with an NHL dynasty afforded less pressure on the ice, easing LaFontaine's transition and helping jumpstart a Hall of Fame career.
LaFontaine looks, Dipsy doubles, he scores! Oh my God, what a magnificent goal!
LaFontaine moving in, fights off the check, and he scores! What a goal by Pat LaFontaine!
But handling the pressure of performing is only part of the transition. For a teenager, living alone in a foreign city can be a daunting proposition. In 1973, as the number one overall pick, Dennis Potman was suddenly thrust into adulthood.
There were many times I never really felt any peace until I got on the ice. I mean, that's really where I felt most comfortable. I was allowed to be creative, allowed to do whatever I wanted to do while on the ice. But after and before games, that was not the prettiest of times. You know, there were transition periods. You know, you live alone, you know, in an apartment. You know, you're faced with daily activities and, you know, life's needs. You know, just shopping, cooking, paying bills, you know, trying to organize, you know, how do I balance a checkbook? All of these things are not things that came easily to me. There's no question for me, off the ice was a bigger challenge than going out and playing. I love that.
Potman and LaFontaine combined for 30 years of NHL experience and over 2,000 points. Each enjoyed remarkable careers, and they offer their simple advice at the outset of Sidney's.
Listen. Listen to your coach. Listen to your teammates. You know, once the skates are off and you're not on the ice, you're not any more talented than the next guy in the dressing room. And listen to what they say. You know, I wish I had at times at a younger age, you know, just be a little more conscious of the fact that everybody's really the same in the dressing room. Everybody's there for a reason. And I think being humble and everything is really nice. But I think being approachable is a lot better. I think he's going to find that in a professional dressing room, he's going to be sitting there with people who are 30, and he's going to have to, you know, gauge, you know, the dressing room and know that he's walking into foreign territory. And no matter how good he is on the ice, he's going to manage that dressing room as well as he does the puck on the ice.
Inner confidence. He's going to have to really believe and keep his confidence level up, and realize that the great players always have this belief and inner confidence that they can achieve and do things. And I think the players that consistently play at a high level have a consistent level of confidence.
Yeah, I'd say those two, you know those describe it the best. I think when you're young and you know, going into a new league, whatever it is, you have to listen for sure. I mean, there's guys who've played in leagues and they know what it's about, and you know, I'm a student of the game, and you know, I don't mind taking advice, and I try to use as much as I can. So obviously that, and you have to have confidence. I mean, you're there for a reason, wherever it is, and there is a reason they picked you, and they see strengths, and you have to use those strengths and not be afraid to use them. You have to be confident to use them, and you know, I think those two things are really perfect. I think when you're going into anything, you have to be ready to learn, ready to listen, but at the same time, you have to have confidence in your abilities and not to be afraid to be creative and you know, do things the way you're used to doing them.
Ryan Lawton and Wayne Gretzky share similar experiences and hype and expectations with differing career results. However, both agree on the most important character trait for success.
The one thing that I believe he'll need to bring, and I believe he has it already, is passion.
Hockey's become such a business, but the reality is you got to have a love and a passion for the game.
He can bring passion for the game, and that can translate over into his work ethic. I think he'll do very well.
Just think about what you do best, and that's play hockey.
That's the key. You got to have passion for this game no matter what.
Everything else will take care of itself. Just play the game and have a love for the sport.
It looks like all roses to the public, but it isn't. It's hard work, it's dedication, it's commitment. It's never ending. You know, it's 12 months a year now, really. And if Sidney can bring that with him to his first training camp, I think he'll do very well. I personally think he already has it, so it's kind of a lock for him.
My goal has always been to be an NHL hockey player. That's been my dream ever since I can remember. So I know my expectations, I know what I'm capable of, so I just try to do you know, things within my means, and you know, it works out.
Next, we examine the potential impact Sidney Crosby will have on the NHL.
All in all, I think if there's anyone out there that has an opportunity to come along and excite the fans and take it to another level, he's the guy.
He's probably going to be one of those athletes where he's never going to be good enough for Sidney Crosby. And I think when you think about the, you know, the Messiers and Gretzky's and Béliveaux and all the great players that played the game, that was a driving force. They want to be the best every night.
Being such great expectations on Sidney is, by what standards will he be judged? is it even fair to hold his performance, statistically speaking, up to the numbers achieved a generation ago?
The league is different now. The scoring aspect is much more challenging now. You don't see guys scoring 212 points, and we may argue that some of these guys, we may try to compare them to Wayne and Mario and the great things they did, but you know, the great players are scoring 100 points now, you know, and that's an unbelievable season. And talented people. I mean, I look at Jerome McGinley last year, and he was unbelievable. He was off the charts, but there were no 150 or 200 points.
When you think about it, Mario Lemieux, who scored on this breakaway on his first shift in the NHL, amassed 100 points in his rookie season. With the way the game has changed, the prospect of Sidney repeating that feat is unlikely. Even so, there is one person who thinks that even if the numbers don't measure up, the impact may.
To say that he's going to score 93 goals in a year because the system may not allow him may be very difficult for him. But all in all, I think if there's anyone out there that has an opportunity to come along and excite the fans and take it to another level, he's the guy.
And as we continue to look ahead and project for Sidney, you cannot ignore the fact that many current superstars were not overnight sensations.
I look at Joe Thornton, who came in and kind of really had a rocky start. And a lot of people, I remember, were kind of all over Joe. And of course, Joe's gone on and done wonderful in the league and is one of the elite players in the league. But he had a rough start that first year. And you know, that can be indicative of just being not immature, but just younger, you know, new virgin territory. You know, Joe was a big, physical, imposing player, and it still took him really almost two and a half years to get it going. Sidney does not have that physical presence, but he does so many other things well that he'll get there. I just think it might take him a little bit of time.
I look at Vinny LeCavalier, you know, I think he took 2 or 3 years, he groomed in, and now he and St. Louis, those two players and that whole team, you know, that came together. And but the first couple years, I think they're pretty tough on younger players.
If everybody could start off playing in the minors, including Sidney Crosby, it clearly would be better for their career. But the nice thing about today's world is that teams have changed their attitude in regards to players, and they're much more patient. And wherever Sidney ends up, I hope that the club isn't in a position where he has to be viewed as the savior.
2003's number one overall pick, Marc-Andre Fleury of the Penguins, is actually thriving in the minors right now without the pressure, which can only be viewed as a positive.
There is no chance for Mark to win 40 games this year, or lose 40 for that matter, at the NHL level. I think Mark's going to have a terrific year as a player, but a terrific year as a person, growing and maturing. I mean, we forget how young these guys are. You know, these are teenagers.
And on the ice, it's the most of the best player in the world to play against. But, you know, off the ice too, I found out that there's a lot I didn't know about, and, you know, I didn't expect to be like that. You know, it's a big business too. It's not just go and play hockey.
Whether Sidney starts in the minors like Fleury or is thrust into the NHL spotlight, there is one aspect of his game by which he'd like to be judged more than goals and points: winning, much like his idol, Steve Yzerman.
Actually, you know, there was a special, like a 5-minute special on him one night. It was like a Saturday night, you know, Hockey Night in Canada. And you just see after he came back from his knee surgery, I think it was the year after the Olympics or something like that, and you see, you know, he was just, the guy is just unbelievable how many times he's come back through injuries, and when he could have just easily retired, but his just passion for the game, I mean, it's unbelievable, and that's something that I really admire about him. And, you know, they asked him at the end of the interview, they said, you know, you have 3 cups, you have all this stuff, what brings you back? And he said, well, 3 is nice, but 4 is better. And I mean, you know, that told the whole story about, you know, how much of a winner he is.
And while comparisons are nice, ultimately, there will be only one person whose opinion truly matters.
He's probably going to be one of those athletes where he's never going to be good enough for Sidney Crosby. He's always going to want to improve and be better, you know, on any given night. And I think when you think about the, you know, the Messiers and Gretzky's and Beliveaux's and all the great players that played the game, that was a driving force. They want to be the best every night. You know, I had a chance to play with a few of those guys, you know, Trache, Bossy, and Billy Smith. And, you know, that's what makes the difference. They care about whether or not they're going to be the best tomorrow night and again the night after. And if Sidney's got it all, got the whole package, as they say, he's going to have that element.
And when all is said and done, what kind of career does Sidney envision for himself?
That's a tough one. I mean, that's so far away, but no, for sure, a nice NHL career with a few Stanley Cups and you know, maybe Olympic gold medal, World Cup gold medal. I mean, you know, that'd be, I guess, the storybook ending for an NHL career. But you know, it's a long ways away. But if I were to look back, some Stanley Cups and a couple gold medals would be nice. That's for sure.
Success is no longer measured by victories alone. Today, the size of one's heart determines success in competition and the community. Whether he can achieve greatness is unknown, but make no mistake, the fuse has been lit. The time for the bright burn of a new star grows near.
Held in by Duchesne. Duchesne pass in deep to Taylor. To Gretzky, he scores! He's done it! Wayne Gretzky is the all-time points leader in the NHL.
Moore across the line, going in, shot, goal!
Kept it in, back for Dennis Potvin. Shot, scores!
To the line, LaFontaine shot, he scores! LaFontaine at the blue line, here in the fourth overtime, firing the shot and winning the series.
He gets it into the air, back to the foot.
I feel kind of stupid, though. Huh? I feel kind of stupid. Excuse me. You girls want to get interviewed?
With?
With NHL Productions.
From what production?
NHL, National Hockey League.
Sure, what do we say?
Well, we're just going to ask you a couple questions.
All right.
What do you girls think about hockey?
It's like tight because it's Canadian.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Are you guys Canadian?
No, we know a lot of Canadian people.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And who do hockey and stuff.
All right, so who's your favorite team?
The Kings.
Kings? That's a good answer in LA. Who's your favorite player?
Wayne Gretzky? Yes.
Wayne Gretzky?
I don't know. We're just going to nod and agree with her.
If you knew that a player was going to be the number one pick in the NHL, would you go out with him?
Not just
because
of that, though.
Wait,
I'm
yeah.
Kind of really stupid.
We're kind of young for that.
Kind of young for
that. All right.
Is there anything you guys want
to ask you guys? Is
mind?
It, like, really hard to, like, be the number one pick? Is that him or something?
Say it again
on
the mic.
I'm not the number one pick yet.
So. Oh. Not yet? Wait, how old are you guys, anyway?
No.
Whoa, we were 16?
Wow, you look older.
How old do I look?
You're 20. Yeah. College.
Like 20. Whoa.
Something. Yeah.
Wow. How old are you guys?
15.
I thought you guys were older. Yeah. How old do you think he is?
20. College.
Same age.
I was going to say that just because.
Wow.
I'm Jack Johnson, this is Sidney Crosby.
Cool.
What are your guys' names?
I'm Michelle.
Leanne.
Marquesita.
All right, well, it was nice meeting you guys.
Nice meeting you too.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, no problem.
All right.
Bye. Bye.